Hello everyone, and welcome to our March webinar, Small Project Evaluation Principles and Practices. Thanks for taking part in our poll. In fact, Checker Cab, Gibson Guitar, Bell's Beer, and the world's only interdisciplinary PhD program in evaluation were all born here in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Iggy Pop was born northwest of here in Muskegon. Today, I would like to introduce our presenters. I'm your moderator, Miranda Lee. Joining me is Lori Wingate from the Evaluation Center at Western Michigan University. Also joining us today is Elaine Kraft, Director of the South Carolina Advanced Technological Center of Excellence and Principal Investigator of Mentor Connect. Also joining us is Charlotte Forrest, who is a Co-Principal Investigator and Project Manager of Mentor Connect. Joining us also today is Russell Cannon, Director of Institutional Research at University of Washington, Bothell. Before we begin, I would like to take a moment to tell you that the views expressed in this presentation are those of the presenters alone, and they do not necessarily reflect the views of the National Science Foundation or of the presenters' home institutions. Behind the scenes, making sure this webinar runs smoothly today, we have Mike Lisecki, Janet Pinhorn, and Tim Suchomsky from MATEC and Maricopa Community Colleges. We would also like to thank Sharon Guskey from Northwest Connecticut Community College and Dennis Faber from Mentor Connect for helping us prepare this webinar. The materials that will support today's webinar include the presentation slides, a handout of key points and resources, and a recording of the session. The handout and slides are already on our website. The recording will be posted within 1 to 2 days, and we will email you the link when that's available. Today's webinar contains 5 parts. We will show you this guide at different points during the webinar so you can keep track of where we are in the presentation. After each section, we will check in with Elaine Kraft for Tales from the Trenches, real-life stories focusing on each piece of the webinar content. We will also have a question and answer break after each section where we will answer audience questions. If you have a question at any time during our webinar today, simply type it in the chat box at the bottom lower right of your screen. I will keep track of those questions. We'll answer them during one of those breaks. If the question is for a specific presenter or discussant, please include their name in the question so I can make sure to address it to the right person. And now, without further ado, I will turn the webinar over to Lori, who will talk about setting the stage for small project evaluations.
Well, thanks, Miranda, and hello, everyone, and welcome. So in this first part of the webinar, I am, like Miranda said, going to set the stage for the content we're going to cover today regarding small project evaluation. But first, I want to point out that whenever you see a colored border like this on a slide, that's going to be a cue to you that we're going to ask you to do something, either answer a poll or type in the chat box. And we're going to have a few polls later in this webinar, and many of you at least did that first one, but I want to make sure everyone knows how to use the poll. So if you look in the upper right corner of your screen now, you'll see a poll question and some answer options. So please read each of the sentences on the slide now. Read them carefully, give it some thought, and select which of the words or phrases you think is the best option for completing all 5 sentences. So is it checking my email, Game of Thrones, Kim Kardashian, or evaluation? Wow, so I don't think it was very hard for you guys to choose, and in fact, the answer is evaluation. I want to draw your attention to that last statement because there is an evaluation survey at the end of this webinar, and it is extremely important to us that you complete this survey, so please do stick around for this. And this webinar is designed for people involved in the National Science Foundation's Advanced Technological Education Program. And later in the webinar, Charlotte will tell you more about that program. But a lot of what you'll hear today will be relevant to small project evaluation in a variety of contexts. In fact, my favorite resource on small project evaluation is by the Juvenile Justice Evaluation Center. And the link for that handout, or their link to that guide that they put out to small project evaluation, is on our webinar handout, which is on our website, which Miranda mentioned earlier. So also regarding context, I want to step out of the evaluation context for just a minute and help us start thinking about big versus small in general. So again, you see a color border, so you know you're going to be asked to do something. So use the chat box to identify at least three similarities between this very small hummingbird's nest and this rather large eagle's nest. So use the chat box this time. And Mike, I wonder if we could not put up the next poll. Can we keep up the old poll until we're ready for the new poll? That way people won't get confused and try to work ahead with the poll. So
yes,
people are using the chat. Thank you, Mike. So yes, they're in trees. They're both nests. They both are for birds. They're made from natural materials. They're in a tree. Right. So there's a lot of similarities in spite of the difference in size. So what are some differences? Yes, one is very small and one is large. We're getting at that. The elevation, the type of bird, type of nest. Somebody's pointing out one of the eagle's nest has two birds and the hummingbird nest has just one. Another key difference that you might not know is that the eagle's nest takes up to 3 months to build and the hummingbird nest takes maybe up to 5 to 7 days. And the eagle works in pairs to build their nest and the female hummingbird has to work alone. So although the general form and the specific function of these nests are pretty much the same, there's a huge difference in the level of time and effort. And the same is true for evaluation of small projects and of large projects. The level of effort and resources required is different, but the general form and function is the same. And whether large or small, evaluation is the determination of something's quality, value, or importance. And when we're talking about evaluation in a professional context, it's really important that it's systematic. And when we're systematic about evaluation, first we have to determine what it is that's going to be evaluated. So we ask important questions about the project's processes and outcomes. Then we gather evidence so we can answer those questions with confidence and validity. And a lot of people will stop there, but we also need to interpret the data and actually answer the evaluation questions. And there's really no point in doing any of this if the information isn't going to be used. So it's important to use the information for accountability to sponsors, to improve our work, to plan the next steps. Now, my friends from CDC who are online may have some concerns that I only have 4 steps here and the CDC framework has 6 steps, but this is really just boiled down. But any approach you look at to evaluation is going to encompass these 4 steps. And regardless of your role in the ATE program, we mentioned that is the context for our discussion today. The next few minutes, we're all going to be helping out a new ATE PI, and that's short for Principal Investigator. And that's the person leading an NSF project. We're going to help her develop an evaluation plan for her small project. Her name's Gwen Generickson, and she submitted a proposal for a small ATE grant last fall. It's called Bio-Inspired Solutions to Human Challenges. And she was recently contacted by NSF, which I believe that is happening this time of year, informed that her project proposal received positive reviews. The reviewers weren't satisfied with the evaluation plan. In fact, there wasn't much an evaluation plan at all. So she's been asked to submit a better plan and a budget for that evaluation. And we're going to help her through that process. So our objective for this webinar is that you're going to be able to replicate this process for your own projects or maybe even help someone else out. So in that mindset, what suggestion would you have for her as to the first thing that she should do? She's basically got to go back to the drawing board to come up with an evaluation plan for this proposed project. So use the chat box here and give her some advice. Carol saying start a logic model. Excellent. We're going to get to that. Can saying talk to those stakeholders. Yep. Identify the project goals. You guys know everything we're going to talk about today. For sure. Find an evaluator. That's very good advice as well. No, Janet, we don't want to panic. We're going to stay calm. We're going to work through this together. My advice would actually be to go back to the ATE program solicitation. That's basically the request for proposals that the foundation puts out for when they're seeking people to apply for grants. So we're going to read through that. First, we're going to go to the evaluation section. It tells us that all ATE projects and centers have to be evaluated, and there has to be an external evaluator involved. So there's a cue that we're going to have to get that into the budget. And it also says the evaluation budget should match the scope of the evaluation. And in the sections on intellectual merit, which is one of the review criteria for NSF, it says the evaluation should be tied to project outcomes and provide useful information. And it also says that if she had previous NSF funding, she needs to discuss what they call her results from prior support, and that means evidence of project impact. But this is her first grant, and her proposal's already in. So this is just something she needs to keep in mind. She's going to want to collect good evidence about this project so she can use it in her next proposal. It's really important to keep that in mind. But the solicitation doesn't tell her how much she should spend on evaluation, and that's often the first question a proposer or a new PI has about evaluation. And the rule of thumb is that we start with 10% of a project's cost in terms of what should be allocated for evaluation, and that's pretty much across the board in any context. And that's a good place to start, and then you could go up or down from there depending on what level of evaluation is needed for the project. Now, before we move on, I really want to caution you here, and I really can't stress this enough. That's why I made this blindingly bright slide here. I'm going to be using actual dollar amounts and time allocations in the next few slides, but these are really just to build the examples to illustrate the process. The numbers I'm going to be using should not be construed as recommendations or guidelines for evaluator costs or their time commitments. This is going to vary widely by evaluator and by project and so forth. So just bear that in mind. These are just—it's just for illustration. So here we have a very simple project budget, and the total direct costs for implementing this project adds up to $139,100, and 10% of that for the evaluation comes to $13,910. So that brings our direct cost to just a little more than $150,000. So then we're going to add in the indirect rate cost. Sometimes this is called facilities and administrative costs. And for her, in Gwen's college, this is 30%. And it may be a lot higher or lower at different institutions. But that brings the project total to just about $199,000. And for the ATE program, $200,000 is the maximum amount for projects that are funded through this track called Institutions New to the ATE Program. So when we're talking about small ATE projects, we're basically talking about $200,000 or less, which is the case for Gwen's project. Now remember, this is for 3 years, so that means Gwen has just over $4,600 a year for this evaluation. And I'm going to recommend putting more up front to allow for some additional work to set up for the evaluation. So we'll allocate $4,800 in year one, $4,000 in year two, and then a little bit less in year three. So how much of the external evaluator's time is this going to buy? Well, first we need to set aside some money for the evaluator to make at least one site visit per year. That's going to be very important. Then we need to know the external evaluator's rate, because Gwen's going to need to give that information to NSF, the daily rate or the hourly rate. And I'm using $100 an hour here. Just for the example, so how many days does this get us from the external evaluator? And that's pretty easy to figure out with some basic math. As you can see here, she has 6 days in year one, 5 in year two, and 4.5 in year three. So how can Gwen get the most out of this relatively small budget? And that is going to be the focus of the rest of this webinar. We're going to be touching on three main points. So first and foremost, we need to make sure that we match the evaluation scope to the project scope. And that's built right into the ATE program solicitation. And this is really critical for a small project evaluation. And with the external evaluator spending just a few days per year on this project, the project team is definitely going to need to be involved in monitoring and helping to implement the evaluation, monitoring the project, that is. And we'll want to maximize the use of existing data, particularly institutional data from the college. So we've set the stage for the rest of the webinar. And next, we're going to hear Elaine Kraft's tales from the trenches. She's worked with multiple ATE projects, big and small, and has a wealth of experience to share. And then after Elaine's comments, we'll have a question break. So anytime you have questions, go ahead and get them in the chat box, and then we can get right to them. Right now, I'm going to turn things over to Elaine.
Thanks, Lori. You've made some really good points here. It's not uncommon to have requests from reviewers for more detail in the evaluation plan. What they're looking for is not just evaluation strategies, methods, or standards to which the evaluation will adhere, but rather, and these are all important, but they want specifics about how your specific project goals and objectives will be evaluated. That's the most common question I see. Most competitive projects have identified an evaluator and have perhaps gotten some language from evaluator to put in the proposal regarding evaluation. But if you just put what we call boilerplate language in the proposal, you're likely to get questions back like in this example. And so you want to make sure that you go one step further and say how the goals and objectives of this specific project are going to be evaluated. And I'm so glad that you talked a little bit about the budget and about the value of having your evaluator on site. There's really no substitute for having an evaluator understand the context in which a project's being evaluated. And the only way to get that is on campus. You need to take a look at the institution, where it's located, what the labs and classrooms look like, actually meet the people that you're going to be working with and communicating with, because it really does need to be a partnership, and you'll be working very closely together for the months to come. And so a site visit is really one of the very first things that needs to occur, and then as you mentioned, to see if there are questions.
Okay, great. Thank you, Elaine. So that brings us to our first question and answer break. If you have questions, please make sure to type them in the chat box. And again, if you have questions for a specific discussant, please make sure you mention them by name. So the first question that we had was, does the NSF have a not-to-exceed rate?
I'll take that, Miranda. And Elaine, if she wants to chime in, she can. And I believe they used to, and they no longer have such a thing. But the key is that it has to be what the consultant makes typically. They can't just inflate their rates because it's a grant. It has to be their normal rate that they charge, you know, anybody else under normal conditions. So I think that's pretty much the rule.
Yeah, that's correct, Lori. I agree.
Okay, thank you. So our next question is, Lori, you mentioned that the external evaluator should have more time in year one in order to set up the evaluation. Can you explain what you mean by that a little bit more deeply?
Sure. Just the bulk of the work happens in the planning and getting things set up. So it would be things like developing or refining any data collection instruments, working with project staff to clarify responsibilities for the evaluation, to determine what's needed in a report to make sure data are collected for that. Russell's going to talk later about creating a relationship with an institutional research person, so that would be an important as well. There's just a lot of things you need to figure out before you actually get started with the evaluation. I would just say that half or more of the work is in the planning, and so you gotta, I'm probably exaggerating a little bit, but you really do need to take time up front to get things in place.
Thank you. Another question is, if you have a program that is very cost conscious and does not want the evaluator to do a site visit or multiple site visits, what's the best way to emphasize the importance of site visits for the evaluation?
I'm going to bump that one to Elaine because I think she's been in that situation before, possibly. Elaine, can you take that?
I think that, first of all, the evaluator can give you some input on that because they will understand. And what you're doing is essentially giving them, a sort of a set amount of money and saying, okay, this is how you're going to get your work done within this budget and within this time frame. And so the evaluator can say, well, I can do this, including the site visits. If you absolutely cannot do a site visit for any reason, then get creative. Sometimes you might have an evaluator whose value is so great to you that you really want to work with them even if they can't do site visits. So you might consider webinars pictures, sending them a lot of photographs of what you're doing, what your labs look like, sort of have a virtual tour of your lab and your site. And then you can exchange information virtually and electronically. But I really would make a case for site visits. Even though there are some other ways you can accomplish some of the same goals, I really don't think there's any substitution for actually being there and seeing the facilities and meeting the people face-to-face.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Lori and Elaine. So we're going to move on to the next section. Please keep your questions coming in the chat box, and I'll record them, and we'll address them at the next question break. So now I'd like to turn it back over to Lori, who will tell us about evaluation scope.
Yeah, so thanks for those questions. So you may recall that one of the review criteria for ATE is about whether the evaluation plan is clearly tied to project outcomes. And many of you mentioned this is the first thing to look at when you need to develop an evaluation plan, so you were spot on with that. In fact, this is the most important thing we can do to maximize evaluation dollars. And so that's what we're focusing on this section of the webinar, and we're going to discuss evaluation-related tasks that the project team members can work on and how to access and use institutional data in later sections of the webinar. So let's go ahead and get to work planning the evaluation for this small project. I noted earlier that the first step is to figure out what the evaluation is going to address. And evaluation's focus, it's often expressed as evaluation questions, which are questions about the project's quality, value, or importance that the evaluation is going to gather evidence for and is going to address. And they should ideally address both the project's processes and outcomes. Daniela Schroeder and I recently developed a checklist of criteria for good questions. There's a link for this on our handout, which is on our website. So after a lot of reading and reflecting on our own practice, we came up with these criteria that evaluation questions should be evaluative. Now that may seem obvious, but often we'll see questions that aren't really evaluative. So what we want here is questions that actually call for an appraisal of a program, not just reporting of discrete data points. They should be pertinent, meaning they should align to the purpose of the project and what stakeholders want to know and need to know through the evaluation. Reasonable in terms of the project scope and age and resources. Specific, meaning they should clearly point to aspects of the program that are going to be assessed. And they should be answerable based on data that can be accessed and the constraints and opportunities that are present in the evaluation context. And most evaluations address more than one thing, so when we have a set of questions, they should be complete, sufficiently complete to answer, to address the purpose of the evaluation and what people need to know. But we don't want to just leap into formulating evaluation questions. First, we need to know exactly what this project is doing and trying to achieve. So I'm going to share the project abstract with you for this Bio-Inspired Solutions to Human Challenges project so you know what this project's all about. In spite of growing demand for technicians among local manufacturers, Budeo Community College has under-enrollment in engineering and pre-engineering programs. So to address this problem, they're developing a general education science course that's intended to attract students with undeclared majors to these programs. And this course is designed to educate and excite students about bio-inspired engineering and design. And that's basically taking patterns and strategies found in the natural world and applying them to human problems. And this course is designed to bring to life these principles from areas like biology and design, economics, engineering, and material science. Doing that through hands-on activities and computer-based simulations. Now, 60% of Budeo College students are female, and they comprise just 15% of the engineering and pre-engineering students. So the project's focus is on attracting female students to this course and motivating them to pursue degrees in these areas. And the project's main activities include completing the course materials, creating a short video about this topic, presentations to admissions counselors and advisors and faculty about the focus and purpose of the course, and enhanced outreach to female students with undeclared majors. So I'm recommending to develop a logic model to really bring the key elements of the project into relief. And the logic model is a way of visually communicating a project's activities, outputs, and outcomes, sometimes resources as well. It transfers the project designer's ideas and descriptions into a concise visual depiction of what the project is doing and what it changes it's seeking to bring about. And if outcomes haven't been articulated in a project plan, then creating a logic model can really spur thinking about what the intended outcomes are. And we're going to create a logic model for the Budio College project together based on what the information we have in the project abstract. So the first part is activities, and this is simply what the project does to bring about the intended outcomes. And these are usually the easiest to identify. So here's just a slightly shorter version of the project abstract I just shared with you. And the activities, as you can see here, are listed quite clearly in a list. So I'm not going to ask you to identify those. We're just going to plug those in right here. Each activity has its own box in that column. Next is outputs. And these are the tangible things that are going to be created through the project activities. These are things you can see, you can document. Things are going to be directly observable. They're often the things that will remain after a project ends. So now it's your turn again. So I'd like you to scan this abstract and identify, we're going to use the chat box again, identify what products or outputs this project will create. Just take a minute to scan that and put your answers in the chat box. Again, outputs are those tangible, directly observable things that will probably remain after the project ends. Okay, we're seeing course curriculum and video. Yeah, the course is produced. Course curriculum. Yeah, you're honing right in on the two most obvious and tangible outputs, which are the course materials and the promotional video. So I'm putting those in the outputs column. Next are the outcomes. So these are the changes brought about by the project's activities and products. So logic models often include three levels of outcomes, so short, mid, and long. But since this project is just 3 years, I didn't include the long-term outcomes in this example. I didn't assign any long-term outcomes. The important thing to note here is that outcomes are about changes in things like what I've listed here on the screen, knowledge, attitudes, policies, broader conditions. These aren't just the project's activities or products that happen to occur later in the project chronologically. It's not about what projects do. It's about what difference they make, what changes they bring about. So if intended outcomes weren't articulated in the project proposal, they really need to be figured out in order to properly plan the evaluation. So here's that same abstract again. I'm going to ask you to use the chat box. What changes does the project intend to bring about in the short term? Now, I'll caution you that it may not be explicit in a project abstract or even a full proposal, and that's not unusual. Sometimes you have to deduce the short-term outcomes. How are you going to get to those ultimate goals you're trying to achieve? So I'm going to check your chat box. Yeah, more female students, enrollment in engineering. We're seeing a lot of references to the female students. Yeah, I think you're focusing in right there on the main purpose of the whole project, but there might be some interim things we need to think about. So in this particular situation, first we need students. We're going to create that course. That's our output. And then we need students to enroll in it. And as a result of them being in that course, we hope that their interest in pursuing a STEM-related degree increases, and that in turn may lead to enrollment. So I would focus in a little bit on the shorter term here. So we put the outcomes there. And I cannot keep up with all the wonderful things that are coming in the chat box, but I'm sure there's an array of ways to characterize these outcomes. And I think this, the diversity of perspectives really shows the value of including multiple stakeholders in this type of exercise. So next, those long-term outcomes. What are we trying to achieve here? In fact, I'm not going to ask you to do that because a lot of you honed in. Actually, I should say midterm. A lot of you honed in right in those. So we're looking for enrollment in engineering programs to increase, and it sure would be great if the representation of women across all STEM programs increased. I didn't include long-term outcomes in this model, but it's clear that the project is a first step in trying to address that shortage of technicians that was mentioned in the project abstract. And we could actually put that in this model as long as it's clear that we're not expecting to bring about that change through this short project. So now we have a nice little logic model that can be the foundation for determining the evaluation questions. And this was really a crash course in logic models. So if you want to know more, I have some additional resources in our webinar handout. So logic models are really good for getting clarity on about what a project is doing and trying to achieve. But our main purpose in doing this as part of evaluation planning is to determine what the evaluation questions should be. And then, so then we have a basis for determining what data we need to collect. So remember, this is the qualities we're looking for in an evaluation question. And Gwen's team has brainstormed a lot of possible evaluation questions, and we're going to help her pick the right ones for her project. So if just one of the following questions, and you'll see the questions in your poll area now in the upper right part of your screen, if just one of these questions could be addressed in the formal external evaluation with regard to the project activities, which one would you select? Which one should we focus on? Okay, so I'm seeing a lot of people honing in on how many individuals did the project reach and how effective are the course promotion activities. Okay, while it is important to know how many individuals the project reached, to me this isn't the level, doesn't warrant a external evaluation to address. This would be something that the project could capture and report in terms of accountability. So I would recommend this question, how effective are the course promotion activities, as a more substantive question worthy of investigation through external evaluation. Now, it would be important also to look at quality of these materials. And my recommendation would be to engage experts on campus and the team to provide ongoing feedback during development, to do some pilot testing to ensure quality during development, but not to devote the external evaluation resource to that. So another poll question, I think it is up. Great. So same thing. If we can only focus on one of these questions for short-term outcomes, which one would you select? Okay, many of you honing in right in on that third question. I was surprised more people were attracted to what extent did the course attract the intended audience. I expected you to have a harder time deciding, but that's okay, because it'd be important in my mind to address both of these questions, how well it's attracting the intended audience and the extent to which the course is influencing student interest. So two important questions there. And then finally, for midterm outcomes, select one of these questions to focus on. All right, I see the answers coming through. Yeah, so a lot of people focusing in on that third question, and I would agree on that. We could separate this into two questions, but I like that it's getting at both the extent of the contribution and the nature of the influence. Is it attracting women in STEM, or is something else going on? And if you have questions about why I didn't pick any of the others, go ahead and put it in a question, but I'm going to go ahead and move on so we stay on time. So we have four evaluation questions, and there may be other ways to phrase these questions. There might be other important questions. We sure want to talk to all the stakeholders, and that just, you know, shows why in a real-life project, identifying these questions should be a collaborative process. And I noted earlier that it's important to ask both process-oriented and outcome-oriented questions, and you can see here we have equal coverage of those two topics. So Gwen is happy we were able to help her sift through all these possible evaluation questions and really get to a manageable scope for the evaluation that she can handle in her small budget. So we've gone through scope. Next, we're going to talk about dividing up the labor. But first, I'm going to turn it over to Elaine for more tales from the trenches, and then we'll have a question break.
Oh, thanks, Lori. I'm so glad that you included the logic model, because those are really very helpful tools for conceiving a project to begin with, getting it set up and getting a good evaluation developed for the project. And as you went through the logic model, you worked from left to right. But what we've discovered is that when you build those logic models, it really makes sense to work from right to left. Just like with backward design that many people use for curriculum development, where you start with the end in mind, this is the same sort of approach. So you want to start with what you want your outcomes to be, and then work backwards to figure out what activities and so forth that you're going to need to make that happen. But looking at the end, with the end in mind, does help you zero in on the most valuable evaluation questions. And it helps you avoid some of the pitfalls for data collection. For instance, one question that popped in my mind was, would somebody want to know the grades that students made in this new course? Well, if you look at the overall scheme of things and what you really want to accomplish with this course, the grades that a student makes in that course really are not the most important piece of data, but rather what impact it had on their opinions of and thoughts about going into the desired curricula. So the logic model can really help you think through a lot of things, including which data you want to collect. Now, go to Miranda.
Okay, thank you, Elaine. So that brings us to our next question and answer break. So there's been some questions from the audience, and first I'd like to start with, in your example, Lori, you did not have a linear logic model between activities, outputs, and outcomes. Would this be preferred?
I didn't catch that. Can you repeat the question? I didn't have okay. A what?
In your example, you do not have a linear logic model between activities, outputs, and outcomes. Would this be preferred?
I don't know what the person is asking by linear. I mean, I did not include arrows between the individual boxes because I want to keep it visually simple. But so I can't answer the question. Maybe the person can add more detail in the chat box.
Sorry. Since ATE is focused on technician education, is it appropriate to include pre-engineering?
Well, yes, absolutely. Engineering technology is a huge area for ATE, and there's often agreements set up between two-year and four-year colleges to channel students from two-year programs to four-year programs, so that could be like the pre-engineering. So definitely. ATE is broader than, it's much broader than just the T in STEM.
Laurie, if I could chime in just a little bit. If the sole purpose of the program is transfer, that is not as well suited for ATE as a program that does prepare students to enter the workforce after 2 years. Transfer pathways are desirable, but if the course of study does not readily provide the student with employment opportunities, then it's probably not as good an ATE fit as some other ideas.
Okay. So there was a clarification on the original question, and it was, should there be outputs that are directly attributed to each outcome and specific activities indicated directly meeting outputs, so effectively about arrows that are mapping sort of in a one-to-one relationship? That was for Lori. Okay. While Lori
Miranda,
is...
if I could chime in just a minute. Logic models that had arrows that the question about linear, that an arrow would go from one entry in the leftmost column, it could go to multiple entries in the next column. And I've seen these arrows crisscross in any number of ways. So it's not necessary that they be linear throughout to be effective.
Okay, thank you. Lori, did you have a...
Sorry, I was on mute, of course, giving my wonderful response, which was similar to Elaine. And I would just say I think sometimes things are intended to work synergistically, so you do end up having a lot of arrows going to everything, and it becomes overwhelming. However, I think if it's called for and you can convey that progression cleanly, that it's a great addition to a logic model. But the whole point is to communicate things succinctly and efficiently. So if it overcomplicates things, I think those more complex relationships can be expressed in narrative form.
The final question that we have is, are logic models required in an ATE proposal?
They are not required. We recommend them. They are not required.
Okay. Well, that is all the time we have right now for questions and answers. So at this point, I would like to turn it back over to Lori, who will talk about data collection and division of labor.
Thank you. Okay, great questions. In this part of the webinar, I'm going to address data collection and dividing tasks between a project team and external evaluator. This is a very, when it comes down to it for a small project, this is something that's got to happen. I'm addressing these things together because some of the work involved in data collection really does have to be broken up because it's just not feasible for an external person to do it all, not on this limited budget, certainly. So what are some ways in which a project team might assist an evaluator, an external evaluator, in an evaluation? So I'd like you to use your chat box here to share your ideas. Again, this could be with regard to data collection, or it could be with regard to other tasks as well. I'm just interested in your perspective on what a project team, how a project team can assist in implementing an evaluation. And I just adjusted my mic because I see someone said I was hard to hear. Sorry about that. So Eva's saying locating the data, providing that, basic project information for sure. Kristen's saying collecting that output data for sure. Oh, we're going to get on that. I feel like you guys read all my slides. I'm tracking enrollment for sure, doing administrative surveys, facilitating data collection. You guys are spot on with this. Absolutely. These are all great ideas, very consistent with what I came up with here, which has the external evaluator responsible for the more technical side of things, and when the external perspective is really important, more independent perspective, I should say. And the project team can assist in many of the things you mentioned, assisting with data collection. And they're really in the best position to keep track of who's involved and what the project is doing. And in the middle, you can see here, we've got shared responsibility for planning the evaluation, interpreting results. And this isn't just about resource efficiency. It's really about making sure the evaluation is relevant and meaningful to all the stakeholders. And because we're going to address how to divide up the data collection related tasks, we're doing that because that really should be part of planning for data collection rather than an afterthought to ensure that things are really feasible. So we're going to dive into the second step that I have in this graphic, which is really about gathering evidence to answer the questions. So in the interest of using our resources wisely, we need to make sure that we collect data that are relevant to the evaluation questions. And a good way to do that is to create a matrix like this one that matches up the evaluation questions with the indicators. So the indicators are those things that we can measure that are going to allow us to answer the questions. And we have a great checklist listed on our webinar handout written by one of the participants in this webinar, Goldie McDonald, that lists criteria for having really good indicators in an evaluation. So you should check that out. Then we're also going to identify the sources and methods for the data, as well as who's responsible. And oftentimes, the timing of data collection will also be included in a table like this. So this matrix shows how we're going to answer the evaluation questions about the question about the effectiveness of the course promotion activities. And the indicators we're using are course enrollment numbers and students' reports of why they enrolled in the course. And the data for that is a survey of students who enrolled. And this is really where we're going to seek a division of labor, with the survey development being led by the external evaluator with input for the project team, and survey administration being done by the instructors. And somebody mentioned that in the chat, because they're closest to the students, and that's going to help with response rates. And analysis being done by the external evaluator. And it's especially important that the external evaluator do the analysis if surveys aren't anonymous or if you have very small sample sizes. And as another practical side note, electronic surveys are going to be a lot less costly because it means you don't have a separate data entry step. And there's a lot of free online survey systems that are accessible. So question two is about the extent to which the course is attracting the intended audience, which again are female students and those with undeclared majors. And we're going to capture these data in the same survey of students who enrolled in the course, so the division of labor is pretty much the same. And evaluation question three is about the course's impact on students' interest in pursuing engineering-related degrees. So we're going to track the number and percentage of students who indicate an intent to pursue a STEM degree, particularly in engineering. And we also want to know about their perceptions of how the course influenced them in this regard. So for these indicators, we're going to use a survey of students who completed the course. So this is a different survey. But the division of labor is pretty much the same. And for our final question about enrollment in STEM programs, we're going to look directly at enrollment data that we'll get from Institutional Research Office. But well before we go asking for those data, the evaluator will work with the project team and Institutional Research Office to define the needed data. And then when it's time to get the data, that IR office will provide it. And we could probably come up with, you know, even more data points without adding much more cost to the project. Right now we just have our two surveys and our institutional research data, but we're keeping things simple for this example, and this is probably adequate to answer our questions. So the main purpose of this exercise is to explicitly identify the data we're going to use to answer those evaluation questions. And this process is really going to help us figure out if our questions are answerable, which again is going to be really critical for a small project and a low budget evaluation. So we've addressed the data collection plan and the division of labor when it comes to data collection. And I just want to go over a couple other things a project team should be doing that's going to help with the evaluation, which is very consistent with what some of you put in the chat box. So the project staff are really in the best position to keep track of who's involved in the project. And this is going to be really important from an accountability perspective. It's also going to help projects determine their broader impacts. And it just doesn't make sense for an external person to try to track all that from a distance. The external person can, however, help the project team to set up a spreadsheet or a database to capture this information. And it's quite easy to pull together descriptive information about the type of people involved and the frequency or depth of their involvement. And it's not just about students. I've listed some other types of people involved that you might want to, that you would want to get information on. Basically, anyone receiving a benefit from the project or helping to implement the project in some way. And the PI will need that information as well for reporting to the National Science Foundation annually, as well as completing for ATE folks the annual survey of PIs. And we have links to those, more information on those documents on our webinar handout. And likewise, the project should maintain a good record of project activities and accomplishments. And I know someone mentioned that in the chat. And we at EvaluATE, so our resource center, we've been maintaining a project resume since about our second year of funding, which was 2009. And this is the first page. It's basically just a record of our funding, staffing, everything we've done, like these webinars, conference presentations, publications, and so forth. And everyone who's contributed to our work, folks like Elaine and Charlotte and Russell, who are on the webinar with us today. And our, again, our handout includes some links for learning more about these very minimally narrative accountability type reports. So our new PI, Gwen, is feeling pretty good right now because we've laid out a feasible plan to get evidence of the quality and effectiveness of her small projects, processes, and outcomes. And that, along with the basic documentation of her project activities, it's not only going to, in a plan form, satisfy the foundation that she's got a good evaluation plan in place, but it's also going to, in the end, position her well to talk about her results of prior support in her next proposal. So we've just gone through one and two. The other steps are for topics for other webinars. Next, we're going to hear from Russell Cannon about using institutional data. But first, we're going to hear from Elaine once more before we have a question break. I'll
forward it to Elaine. Well, just very quickly, Lori, this idea of who should do what with the evaluation is really a good question. And it should be a collaboration with the project personnel working in support of the evaluation and, of course, the evaluator working in support for the good of the project. And what I would say to the people who are going to have projects from an evaluator perspective is to be sure that you understand timelines. That's a very important part, because frustration can result if the evaluator needs data and they're not getting it from the project. And sometimes you have to be creative. For instance, you referred to the institutional data. Well, in this particular hypothetical project, you've got a course. There may only be one or two sections of this course. And the instructors who teach that course may be able to give you some data on the enrollments in that course more quickly than you can get them from your institutional research people. So sometimes you have to be clever about how you go about getting your data and try to get it in a more timely fashion, because the institutional research offices tend to be very busy, and if your request is not in there or early enough and they don't really understand what it is you need and you haven't articulated your request very clearly, sometimes delays occur there. And so I would just encourage people to really think about the most time-efficient way to get the data and to make sure that you're on the same page with your evaluator in terms of when that data can be available and for the evaluation. Now back to Miranda.
Okay. Thank you, Elaine. So that brings us to our next question and answer break. So remember that if you have any other questions, so please type them in the chat box, and I'll go ahead and get started. So Lori, how important is having an external evaluator on a project like this? Can an internal evaluation specialist do all of it, or do you need an external evaluator?
Well, I can speak for the ATE program specifically. It states that there must be a line for an external person in the budget for an external evaluator. However, that can be someone who's just not on the project but at the institution. So it could be someone who has evaluation expertise who just doesn't work on the project. It could be someone in an institutional research office. But that would just need to be spelled out in the evaluation plan. I think for other types of projects, you know, that don't have specific funding requirements, then I don't think necessarily it has to be an external person, as long as there's internal capacity in the project to do the evaluation work.
Thank you. The next question is there any particular line in terms of what makes an evaluator external? How far removed do they have to be?
I think from from the National Science Foundation perspective, it couldn't be someone who's you couldn't be an evaluator on a project led by someone you report to. Probably not for someone who reports to you. I think that you need to demonstrate independence. So it's less about being external to the institution, but being independent from the project and decisions, you know, decision making within the project. So I think having a distinct unit on the same campus is okay. Again, I think it needs to be explained in the project proposal. But that would be, I think that it needs to be sufficiently independent. You know, that's on the surface of it. Of course, you could have your best friend, and it looks like you're, you know, very distant, you know, administratively, but it's your best friend. You just got to use your own ethics at that point.
Thank you. So what if institutional research is very hesitant to collect data? How can we get buy-in?
I think that's going to be a question for after Russell's section, because he's actually a director of institutional research, and he's going to have great perspective on that.
Based on question 4 of your evaluation questions, how might you know that enrollment increases are attributed to the program?
Right, so that we're not setting up, and I was careful not to say, you know, caused it or something. We have to look at things logically. We have to look at what else is happening in the context of the program. I think in this very small situation, the most important thing to do would be to ask the students. If none of the students from this course are channeling into these programs, then it would be hard to make a case that it was due to the project, right? So we can find out if the students who enrolled in the course, the degree to which they actually made decisions to go into those programs and that was influenced by their experience in the course. That, to me, would be pretty compelling evidence, but in the absence of that, that would be a problem. So you do have to use logical reasoning. You're not going to set up an experimental design to answer that question. And that's, you know, that's for sure a constraint of a small project situation.
Along those lines, then, how would you control for confounding influences when looking at enrollment trends?
Well, again, you're not doing a full-blown research study on this. You're looking for, did your project, you know, do a good job in implementation? Can you make a reasoned argument with evidence that they achieve the outcomes? I think it's really good that you guys, that people are being skeptical. So you need to think through that. Like, again, it's about matching your questions to your evidence. And if you get to a situation where, like, we can't possibly answer that question with evidence we have, you need to change the question. You can talk, you can make an argument, a reasoned argument with the evidence available that the project is moving toward these outcomes. And that's why it's good to have sort of interim. You don't just focus on those main outcomes. You focus on the small steps that it takes to get to those outcomes. I would encourage people who are wrestling with these issues to look at the Common Guidelines for Education Research and Development put out by the National Science Foundation and Institution for Education Sciences, which spells out, I think, six, I don't know how many levels of different kinds of research. And when you get to impact research, what they call impact research, the standards are much, you know, the standards of rigor are much higher. And so these are definitely issues that come into play when you're talking about impact research. So I would encourage folks to check on that. If you Google, if you put common guidelines as a keyword in our website, we have a checklist version of that, which also links to the main document.
Okay. In terms of interviews, focus groups, and surveys, interviews and focus groups are costly. Do you mostly recommend surveys, or when would you recommend using other data collection methods?
Elaine might want to chime in on this. I do think intensive qualitative data collection is extremely expensive in terms of the time it takes for analysis. If you don't need in-depth analysis, you just want to, like, scan a transcript or something and see that generally what people are saying, I think it's probably okay. It's definitely pretty inexpensive to do an electronic survey. And yes, you can include qualitative items on there, but you know, the quantitative items are much quicker and much easier to analyze. In terms of getting rich information, if you really want to find out, like, how your project is working, you know, if it's working with an individual level, I think those the more in-depth qualitative processes can be quite revealing. So again, you got to balance what's the purpose of the evaluation, what do we really need to find out, and what's the best way to get that information. It's not like a blanket answer to that, unfortunately.
Okay, and then the final question for this break was, in the bio-inspired example, you stated that 500 was potentially the amount equivalent for one on-site visit. Is that correct?
Oh, my gosh. No, I have no idea, right? I'm guessing that's about what it would cost for somebody to come within a day's drive and possibly spend the night. So it really depends on where your evaluator is coming from. It wouldn't ever probably be enough if the person had to fly in. So again, when you're selecting an evaluator, that's something really to take into consideration. You don't want half your budget sucked up in travel costs. So please, as I put in that giant warning sign, please don't take any of those numbers as a recommendation. You really have to look at your own situation and where your person is coming from, how much time they need to spend, and so forth.
Okay, thank you. So that brings us to the end of the question break. Make sure to keep your questions coming in the chat box, and we'll answer them during the next break. And now I'd like to turn it over to Russell Cannon, who will give us some tips about how to work with institutional research offices.
Russell? Perfect. Thanks so much. So we've heard some great examples of how to be efficient in matching scope, how to work with partners. So now we'll turn to some strategies on how to actually get the data. And in higher ed, that very often means a conversation with institutional research, or as it's often abbreviated, IR. I should say that IR looks different in different schools, and what I'm offering here is just my own perspective. I do come at this both as someone who works in IR and as a researcher in a higher ed research lab in Wisconsin where we do a fair amount of evaluation. So between those two capacities, I've had the opportunity to serve on both sides of the data request, so to speak. But that's the perspective from which I'm addressing this. So you may recognize this first slide as the last scene of Indiana Jones, the Raiders of the Lost Ark, just after the title character has been assured that this priceless treasure is being looked at by top men, when in actuality it's being crated up and wheeled into an airplane hangar full of lots of similar-looking crates. And, you know, as much as we like to talk about being data-driven in higher ed, there's at least a little bit of a metaphor here. And that we're pretty good at getting data archived. We're not always great at making it actionable. And in as much as that's the case, you can think of IR as sort of the archivist. It oversees at most institutions reporting. The office often conducts research on the school for the school, if that makes sense, and handles both internal and external data requests. And I'm always reminded when folks ask me about sort of how to work with IR of some advice I received from a history professor who told me that the most valuable research method she ever learned was how to talk to the archivist. I remember saying, you know, these folks, they're not going to know your subspecialty in the detail that you do. They may not have your same degree or training. But the archivist knows the archives, and they know it better than you, they know it better than anyone else, they know it better than whatever you can find online about what's in there, and that can be incredibly valuable. And so in that same way, IR at most institutions is the place to go to learn both what data is available, including pointing you to things you may not have thought of, as well as a place to get a good sense of data's limitations. So what data points are less useful because they're inconsistently captured, because the snapshot dates are off for any number of reasons. And so there may be other folks who can tell you, maybe even in IT, you know, here, yes, we do have a data field that says GPA from high school, but they may not know that that's only there for 30% of students, and it's known that it's wrong for half of those or something like that. An added benefit of institutional research is that because they are that central hub for data requests, they often have a pretty good sense of what other evaluations are happening on campus and the data that they are using, so a good sort of big picture perspective. And then finally, a sort of important thing to keep in mind is that it's very common for folks in IR to be trained in social science research methods. They may even be responsible for conducting internal evaluations for the institution. So it's very possible that they're able to sort of speak your language of evaluation and provide another set of eyes in the early stages as you're developing your strategy. You know, I personally am always excited when someone is looking to put the data to good use and is willing to have a conversation about how to do that well. And so with that in mind, we'll turn to sort of a few tips on how to work with IR. And this slide is simple, but boy howdy is it important. Just first and foremost, I'd say, as someone's already mentioned this today, go to institutional research early. At any given moment, the office is probably juggling 20 different data requests. If you wait until close to the deadline, not only are you going to be dealing with a stressed out IR office that may not be your best partner in that moment, but there's not going to be the space to take full advantage of all the data that's available. There's going to be very little time to pivot if things change, and there's even some possibility you might not get what you need in time. So get your data request in early while you're still in your planning stage, while you're making that logic model. Many IR offices will have a data request form. Absolutely fill that out, set the stage, but also I really recommend that you ask to meet in person, to sort of sit down and have a face-to-face conversation. And I think that can go a long way. In terms of efficiency, that extra time cost in that moment will be worth it in the long run. And so in that first conversation, I really would encourage you, beginning when you're still in the planning stages and starting the conversation with what you want to find out, then turn to the data elements that will best fit your needs. So, you know, are you trying to figure out if students will become more engaged in their communities, that they will end up in STEM careers, that they will increase their financial literacy? Start there and then take the opportunity to explore what data may speak to those things. Now, one sort of flip side I'll say to going to IR early is absolutely, you can have these conversations, but you probably don't want that to be your only interaction. There is just being real with myself and the world that's out there, there's a way in which the squeaky wheel gets the grease, right? So it's very important to follow up even after you've made your initial data request. Still several weeks out, how are things going? Is there anything else you need from me? These are just ways to work effectively with IR offices. The final thing I'll note, just all of these equally crucial, is come bearing documentation, okay? If there is a required plan from the funding agency, are there definitions? You know, when you say retention, is there a very specific definition of retention that's provided by the funding agency? Are there particular dates by which you need things? Now, and to be clear, it's not uncommon for funding agencies to be really vague about some of these things, and that's okay. What I say there is first, make a phone call. Actually get on the phone with them and see if you can sort of push them towards a definition, and if they sort of push back and say, no, we don't really have more specificity than what we've given, then take the time to come to an agreement about these things with IR office, because there's nothing worse than having an IR office spend hours pulling data and then coming back and saying, oh, you know what, it turns out that what we thought we were asking for with retention, we described it incorrectly, so here's the way we really need it. Go ahead and iron those things out first. It's one of those things, measure twice, cut once, right? And so with that in mind, let's change now to what actual data IR offices have access to. And again, this can vary somewhat from institution to institution, but often if IR doesn't have it, it can at least point you in the right direction. This first slide is the classics. This is the golden oldies, the go-tos that just about any IR office anywhere is going to have access to. Because they are required for federal reporting. And there are lots of requirements about the quality of that data. Now, as Lori mentioned earlier, the unifying theme of today's presentation is about efficiency. And everything that I'll mention in terms of these data elements are things that in theory you could probably try to collect yourself, but it is incredibly time-consuming to do that. So remember that when you're using institutional data, you're not just taking advantage of the data itself, but you're taking advantage of all the institutional processes that collected it and that verified that data. And the professionals that knew the sort of official federal definitions, and those are things you can't always get when you're interacting with, for example, the faculty member that teaches the course or an office that may have access to the data but is not familiar with the definitions. As I mentioned, these data elements on this first slide, the sort of student demographics information, enrollment information, also to some degree some sort of top-level budget information and financial aid information are all things that are institutions are federally mandated to report to the Integrated Postsecondary Education Dataset, or IPEDS. Now, there's still ways in which this data is imperfect. There will still be some missing data elements for some students, but it's sort of the closest thing that we have in truth. And for these data elements, the institutional data is usually considered the so-called source of record. Again, sort of is the best we got. But in addition to these, which I think most of you are probably familiar with and you might think of when you're thinking of an IR office, I encourage you to think outside the box in a few different ways. So one area that some IR offices will have control over, or they can at least point you in the right direction, is institutional surveys. You'll find these in almost every school. In some cases, be tied to student ID, so you could track students in your particular cohort. More likely, the surveys will at least have demographics questions that let you come up with a sort of baseline or comparison group information. Common surveys are admitted student surveys, new student surveys, first year and senior engagement surveys like NESE, graduation surveys, and alumni surveys. Just about any institution will have at least a few of those. A second sort of source of information that can be really helpful, a little out of the box, is just a list or maybe just a sense of what other programs exist on the campus. These can be things that are happening in student affairs or in a student success office or in a different academic program. And these groups can be partners They can be potential opportunities for embedding assessment, especially if it's something like a first-year program that all students go through. They can also be confounders, right? So it can be really helpful to know if the same year that you're trying out your intervention, there's this other huge thing that's affecting all first and second-year students, right? So that could be a really helpful set of data points. And then the final thing, and this really varies from institution to institution, but increasingly, institutions are trying to track student behavior a little bit more carefully with things like ID card swipes. So you can learn things like, have the students in your cohort been attending tutoring sessions? Have they been going to the library more often? Have they met with an advisor recently? Again, not always the case, but IR can often point in the right direction on that. And then, so we've talked about out of the box. We'll now sort of talk about out of the room that the box is in, right? So these are a few areas to which the institution may submit data, and both the central data sources and the data that get submitted can be helpful. So the first is the National Student Clearinghouse. This is a national nonprofit that gets quarterly reports from registrars. It's something like 95% of institutions in the country. It can be used to track whether students who leave your institution have ended up somewhere else, so at another higher ed institution, and including in graduate school. It can be very helpful because it also captures students who move out of state. And IR can often help you facilitate or can help facilitate a request to the National Student Clearinghouse. The next one is relatively new, state longitudinal data sets. They're now required of states by the federal government. They're imperfect because they're relatively new. They only track student movement within a single state, but they can be really powerful if you're interested in what happens to students after they finish school. Not only can they track whether students are transferring to another institution within the state, but often they can track whether they are employed, what their salary is, and what their career field is. That can be really important if you're interested in not just getting STEM degrees out there, but getting students into STEM careers, for example. And then finally, I thought we'd just take the example we provided earlier, the Bio-Inspired Solutions to Human Challenges class that sort of, you know, long story short, is trying to increase the number of pre-majors that are going into STEM, particularly women, and sort of taking that as a way to say what data might be brought to bear to this type of evaluation that IR might be able to help you with. So one set of data is probably just baseline demographics. I know that was one of the points on the quiz that not as many people chose. And yet, if we're saying that a core outcome of this is increasing women in STEM, then there's sort of no way that that could work, right, if the course itself enrolls no women, right? So it can be really helpful to know sort of what's the baseline information, both for the campus, for engineering in particular, for intro courses. You know, is the campus 10% women? In that case, it might be very ambitious to try to get 15% women in STEM. Is the campus 60% women? It's a very, very different scenario. There may be even a similar course out there, right, that maybe it's not doing what we want it to. Is that course serving as a gateway course? That is to say, there are already lots of women in that course, but then none of them are moving to STEM. Or is the course somehow dissuading women from even signing up for the course? Are there very few women in that course, even though there are lots of women in the institution? These can both be helpful in getting a sort of sense of a baseline, and then when you're looking at the new course, a sense of how you've done with your outreach outcome. Retention is probably important to you at lots of levels. You know, A, is the student finishing the course? B, is the student eventually graduating from that institution? Now, you can graduate from the institution but never have a STEM major. Is the student getting a STEM major? And is the student then staying in that STEM major until a STEM degree? These are all data points based on enrollment data, where institutional data is probably going to be your source of record, and IR can help you out. But then as we also start to think about some of these out-of-the-box possibilities, you know, maybe it's that these students are, you know, getting really interested in STEM, but maybe it's a STEM program that your institution doesn't offer. So it may be considered a success if they are transferring to another institution and taking on a STEM degree there. So that's something you might be interested in tracking, or getting a graduate degree in STEM. And then finally, surveys and course evaluations and other sort of out-of-the-box sort of thing could be helpful in evaluating outcomes. Are students coming to the institution saying that they're interested in STEM and then they're not signing up for this course and not going into STEM? Or are very few women coming to the institution saying that they're interested in STEM? So part of what you're doing is just increasing their desire to even consider it, right? And then course evaluations, which I are sometimes overseas, but they can at least point you in the right direction, can give you a sense of what's actually happening in the classroom. You know, just a limited snapshot, but it's something. So again, this is only a very simplified example, but hopefully gives you a sense of some of the data elements that can be brought to bear for this type of evaluation and how a partnership with IR can get you to that point. Thanks.
Russell, this is Elaine, and I was interested in your putting the iPad data on your screen because that's one data source that sometimes gives us some trouble in the ATE program because it tracks first-time, full-time freshmen, and we serve a lot of students who don't fit that definition. So I would just caution people to be careful about the iPads data because of the definitions of the students that are being tracked with that particular data. Just want to tell you a couple of go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, yeah, absolutely, a great point. The balance you're constantly striking with the federal data is the accessibility you have to peer comparisons if you use the federal data versus the ability to sort of set your own definitions and get into that sort of level of granularity that you may need for your evaluation. So great point.
Just a couple of sort of stories from the field. It is important to help your IR department, your data person, understand what it is that you need. I worked with a project recently that is working with some dual credit high school students. And only after they started talking with their IR office did they discover that the college was not tracking those dual credit students by program. And so they couldn't tell how many dual credit students coming out of the high schools were actually entering their program. And so that actually resulted in a change in data collection at the college because they realized that that would be really good information to have. But nobody had asked for it before. So sometimes you can affect some positive change by asking some questions and working on some of these projects. Another thing that you can think about in terms of collecting data is in arming your principal investigators and project teams to help you with this is developing, for instance, for the qualitative information, some interview protocols or information that they would consistently ask various people. I've been working with a project that did a faculty development workshop last summer, and then armed, equipped, and prepared this group of about 18 or 20 faculty members to go back out to their institutions and implement some new instruction and use some new tools in their classes. And so part of their project plan was that the principal investigator and another project team member were going around and visiting each one of those classroom sites during the year to see how they were using the information and the tools that they were provided the summer before. Well, for a small grant, which is sort of the focus of this webinar, there's simply not going to be budget for your external evaluator to go to every one of those 20 teaching sites. Each one of these individuals came from a different school or community college. And so by arming your project personnel who were going to be making these visits anyway with data collection tools like a set group of questions or protocol for getting information from the participants is really a way to leverage your evaluation dollars in a situation like that. So back to Miranda.
Thank you, Elaine. So that brings us to the next question and answer. And there was a particularly, there was a question about what to do if the institutional research department is very hesitant to collect data. How can you get the buy-in? And that question is for Russell.
Sure, yeah, that's a great question. I think you know, I'd point to the sort of three slides I gave for examples of how to work with IR, and I'll tell you right now, boy, I'm a lot more hesitant to engage in data collection if someone is approaching me very close to the deadline. If we're being brought in sort of without a lot of detail on sort of what exactly is being asked for, and if we're being brought in being asked just to collect a specific data element without an understanding of how that contributes to the outcome and without a sense that sort of the other options have been explored. So really, if your goal is getting buy-in, and you know, in a perfect world where all IR staffs were huge and they could just deal with every data request as written, this might not be as necessary. But I think that is an important question. I think it's so important to engage them and engage them early, and to help them sort of draw the line between what's needed how to get there. And it may be, you know, if we're talking about actually collecting data element, that's very different from going out and looking at data that already exists, right? So it's very different to run a report than to create a new data collection mechanism. So trying to think about which is more appropriate, and whether, you know, IR may not actually be as well equipped to do the data collection. And at many institutions, that's not part of their role. It's just working with the data when they're there. So I think, you know, just that early conversation will help determine sort of the best pathway forward and the best chance of buy-in.
Well, thank you, Russell. Unfortunately, we need to move forward to make sure that we have time for Charlotte Forrest to talk to us about the ATE program and mentor. So please make sure to keep those questions coming in the chat box, and we will have one final question break at the end. Until then, Charlotte.
Hi, everyone. The ATE program focuses on strengthening technician education at post-secondary and secondary levels for high technology fields that drive our nation's economy. So with that, whether you are just now taking advantage of ATE or advanced technological education funding, or you're like Gwen Generickson, who is writing a proposal and honing in on her evaluation, we want to make sure that if you're interested in this type of funding, that you're very keen on the emphasis on evaluation, and that you are reading your program solicitation very closely, and that you understand the requirements of the program. As you can see, there are a plethora of opportunities in the ATE program. For example, centers, they span four different ways that you can be funded. Centers usually have a scope that involves partnerships, industry, overarching reach, and so forth. Targeted research grants, these are grants that have a very solid evaluation base. They have areas of impact for the ATE program, and they are an opportunity for you should you be looking at funding sources through the ATE program. And then finally, projects. Projects incorporate partnerships, workforce industry need, innovation, you name it. And as you can see, there are plenty of examples here. Today, our focus has been on the small, new to ATE for institutions new to ATE. So with that being said, for this particular program, which has been the emphasis of the webinar today, only community college campuses that have not taken advantage of ATE awards in the past 10 years or ever may apply. This is, as you've seen, $200,000 max over the course of 2 to 3 years, and the typical awards made per year span between 12 and 20. The proposal rates for grant programs in the ATE environment can be a bit alarming, and as you can see, historically, the funding rate has ranged anywhere from 20% to 34%, and this is including all centers, projects, and those other sources of funding. Now, allow me to attempt to remove the worry. In the new to ATE category, the funding rate has staggered between 65% and 70%. So if you are considering a small grant, how the highest probability of being funded is through this new to ATE category. And that's very notable, seeing all that we've said about evaluation during this webinar. As represented, the new to ATE category funds up to $200,000. That's sometimes with the high indirect cost, and sometimes it doesn't necessarily seem appetizing. However, let me set the stage for opportunity with the Advanced Technological Education Program. Many, not all, however, of ATE centers and large projects that now exist begin as small projects. Over time, with fabulous evaluation practices, lots of partnerships and collaboration, and not to mention innovation, projects can be super, super successful and have the opportunity to scale. One example is our South Carolina ATE Center of Excellence here at Florence Darlington Technical College, where Mentor Connect is housed. This began as a planning and large project grant that has now spanned a national focus centered around faculty development, curriculum development, and mentoring. The center now has lots of project initiatives and sub-awards. We cannot emphasize enough with that example the importance of strong evaluation as you begin your small projects. Setting your team up for success with top-notch evaluation practices and a serious look at who and how you work with your evaluators is super, super important. Mentor Connect is a leadership development and outreach initiative for the Advanced Technological Education Program that is in its second cycle of funding as a project until 2020. Our mission is to help underserved and underrepresented community colleges benefit from grant opportunities and to diversify the pool of prospective PIs for the NSF ATE program. All of this is accomplished with a variety of mechanisms and strategies. So we ask that you please visit our website and check us out because, again, we can help you make sure that you're using best practices in not only evaluation but all aspects. The program, Mentor Connect, accepts 20 colleges across the country each year into a cohort mentorship that runs over the course of at least 10 months. Those receiving one-on-one mentoring are engaged and provided guidance through a mentor in the ATE community. The ultimate goal is the grant proposal submission to the new to ATE program category and hopefully funding through the NSF ATE program. Our team, we have lots of guidance, as you can see here, and we are definitely keen on helping anyone who is interested in the program. So, as I conclude, the project team is dedicated to helping those who are interested in the variety of opportunities that impact your future success with ATE. Like Gwen Generickson, who is now hopefully on her way to a solid evaluation, she can use that evaluation to scale up projects in the future and seek out assistance. So thank you.
Okay, thanks, Charlotte. So those were, I see that there was a number of questions that were answered in the chat box. Unfortunately, we're running low on our time together today. So if you have additional questions, you may be able to send an email to info@evaluate.org with any additional questions that aren't covered in today's webinar. Remember at the beginning of our time together today, Lori mentioned that we would have an evaluation survey. The link to the evaluation survey just appeared in the upper left-hand corner of your screen. So please make sure to visit that survey and provide us with information about your experiences today. While you're doing that, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you all for participating today. I'd like to thank our presenters from EvaluATE and from Mentor Connect, Elaine Kraft, Charlotte Forth, and Russell Cannon from University of Washington, Bothell. Thank you all, and thank you to the audience for having a wonderful experience today. Take care, and hopefully we'll see you at our next webinar.